I always tell people that you're more capable than you think you are.
Be original. Don't be like the guy on the radio. Great music will prevail. So I would tell people, make great music. Don't make other people's music. Make your own.
Money don't make me, so I just say, you know what? I just gotta be happy in my life. Build your team. Look around you. Figure out all these parts, because you can't do it all yourself. You're gonna burn out and get tired.
Never burn any bridges. You never know who someone's gonna be.
I must not fear. Fear is the mind killer.
Welcome to the Indie Playbook, presented by Focus Noise. Today's episode, I've got one of the legendary MCs from one of the most creative groups of all time, the Pharcyde. My man, Tre Hardson, AKA Slimkid3. And aside from being such a dope MC and a creative mind, Trey's also a black belt in Taekwondo. He teaches meditation and even hip hop classes to kids. Tre drops so much knowledge, and we got into everything from music to the business, to drugs, to sex, to everything. So without further ado, here's Tre Hardson, AKA Slimkid3. Let's get into it. Say you're talking to an 80-year-old woman, right? She knows nothing about your career.
Okay.
How do you briefly explain who you are and what you do?
Oh my God, 80-year-old woman.
Yeah, she's clueless.
The generation gap is so far, man. Because she would be like, oh, that's nice. At the end of our conversation, I already know how this ends. How would I explain to her? I would just say, you know, I would just be honest. You know, I'm a rapper. What exactly is a rapper? She would probably ask. And I was, you know, or, you know, I'm just doing the hip hop stuff, because she would say, oh, is that hippity hoppity stuff?
Right.
And I would be like, yes, it is that hippity hoppity stuff. And, but, you know, mine's is like kind of energetic and, you know, it's nice and fun. We, you know, is it, you know, talk about, you know, bad things about women or this, that, and the other. And I'll say, no, at least mine's doesn't.
I can tell you've had this conversation.
Oh, I've had this conversation before, man. And it's, and you know, like my grandmother in general, I mean, like for instance, rather, you know, just explaining to her what I'm doing, like, oh, so you're going back down to the studio? Oh, so you're making your record? Like, right. Like, yeah, mom, making my record and going down to the studio. Oh, well, that's nice. So it's like, sometimes it's not really, there's a super disconnect there.
Right.
But they're always proud of you. As long as you're doing something positive.
That's true.
Because I've had these conversations with, you know, 80-year-old women about what I do as a DJ or as a MC. So
right.
That's
so,
usually how it comes
and
out.
And the positivity, that takes me kind of to my next question, right?
Yeah.
So you grew up in L.A.
Yep.
And from South Central?
South Central, yep.
Okay. And so obviously, kind of as you were coming up, what was getting the attention was the NWAs and gangster rap became synonymous with South Central LA, right?
Yeah.
What was the hip hop scene in LA like late 80s?
Late
80s. Yeah.
So there was NWA, and so like you know, my friends and I were, you know, running the streets doing dirt and stuff like that. And we would have NWA playing in the, you know, that would get us amped for, you know, about to go to the party or about to go do this thing or whatever. It was young. It was, you know, like, well, I was like 17, 18 or something like that with my boy Kai Mackey, my boy Thomas, my boy Jeff. Imani, of course. And we would go to either, you know, Hollywood Live, or we would go to a place called Zap where my boy DJ Tony Stewart would be DJing and stuff like that. hammer pants. He had some hammer pants, you know, like kind of like the baggy pajama pants things. Got the monkey boots on, right. You know, the t-shirt, just the baggy look, and ready to get down on the dance floor and just, you know, battle cruise, you know, on the dance floor type stuff, you know. So it was kind of a good scene.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Because it was definitely intermixed. You had the NWA gangster rap type of stuff, and then you had this other gangster rap stuff. It was like, it was all right, but, you know, like if you're from those, you know, different areas, you can hear what's gangster rap and what's just like, just some whack rappers just, you know, trying to follow a trend. But then that was, you know, like the NWA was mixed with, you know, we had X-Clan that was playing, mm-hmm. or we had KRS-One, BDP stuff, you know, like that was all like kind of like the intermix of the East Coast stuff and then the West Coast stuff. So the environment was very good.
Right. And did you start out as a dancer?
Yeah. Yeah. I started out as a battle dancer, break dancer.
B-boy. Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
So I read you guys performed on In Living Color back
then,
right?
Yeah, we performed on In Living Color. We were friends with Rosie Perez, mm-hmm. In the dance scene. And also, oh, my gosh, I can't think of her name. Oh, Mickey, you're so fine. You blow my mind. Hey, Mickey. She's going to kill me because I didn't. You know how like names just run out of your head?
Yeah.
Tony Basil, man.
That's it. Yeah.
So, you know, we were in the scene with that, and like we were like some pretty hardcore, you know, battle dancers. And there was always like the Soul Brothers was friends of ours and a lot of crews out there. And we'd all, you know, go to these different auditions to be in videos or to be in movies or, you know, at this particular time to be on In Living Color. And it's not like, you know, we knew Rosie, but that didn't mean that she's going to give it to us.
Right.
You know what I mean? We had to go do our thing. And Rosie knew, you know, she was super cool. She's like a big sister or something to us. You know what I mean? Like, so we were definitely getting it in.
Right.
You know, going in, practicing, get to the audition, ripped it, you know what I mean? And I mean, the rest is kind of history kind of thing.
Did you feel like that was like your big break when you first got on there?
There was just times where you would think about your big break. And then there's times it's like you thinking about, we got to eat.
Right.
And well, this is a hustle. And we put all of our energy into going super hard to become the Pharcyde, meaning nobody had jobs anymore. Like one, there was like, I remember when like just Roma had a, Booty Brown had a job.
Right.
And so he would be taking care of us, or whoever got a check, we'd be taking care of the whole crew. Cause it was like, it was us, the 2 for 2, and it was GTI, crew as well, which were the super duper dancers. Like I was just like kind of, I was just in the dance circle with the folks, but GTI was the core. There was Miguel, my boy Miguel, Brenton Bailey, Romai, Imani, and those guys with the core. Like when we go to the dance battles, they would be doing a set thing on stage, mm-hmm. and everybody knew about us, and you know, like stuff like that. And then we would go to we would just show up at the different circles of dance crews, and we were just like family, mm-hmm. you know what I mean? So there was a time where the stardom part, and this is our big break, didn't even come into our mind. It wasn't our focus at all. And that was a good thing, because it's like we kind of didn't get distracted, because we were super into what it is that we had to do. You know, there was Fatima was in the circle of folks, and Fatima was friends with my cousin Janine Hartson and Tish. And they were like the girl us.
Right.
But and they were super bad.
Yeah.
They were super dope. So Fatima went on to do choreography for Michael Jackson, Remember the Time video and stuff like that. So but it was all about we were just focused on our craft. And I feel like all the other parts just like kind of like, you know, developed around us.
Right.
but we were happy when these moments came along. So we were just keep going. We just kept going.
So what was your vision at the time as a group?
Our vision as our main focus at the time was like to, you know, we would do a lot of, showcases with Reggie Andrews, because he would bring like a lot of different labels around for us to get the 2 for 2 action off. Our old, it was the name, Pharcyde was called 2 for 2 at first, you know, and so we were doing so many showcases and stuff like that. So that was our big picture.
Right.
You know what I mean? So there was a time where I think it was like Third Stone, which in turn became Interscope. We were supposed to be in that little, we were supposed to get signed to like Third Stone or Interscope or what have you. And we was excited about that, and that situation fell through. And so then we were just like, you know, we still knew where our target was, but inside we were just like, sometimes you kind of feel kind of lost, you know, like, damn, you know, we did everything, you know? And so we just stopped giving a fuck, you know what I mean?
Right.
So, next thing you know, we would get, so our relationship with our manager at that time, like we kind of went our different ways, and Paul Stewart, you know, came along, and he was like, yo, you know, I want you to, you know, we're going to take some meetings with some different labels. And in our mind, we were like, okay.
Right.
Because we were, you know, we were kind of jaded a little bit, but still we still had that fire of, you know, just having fun about life.
Right. So Paul gave you your first real big opportunity.
Oh yeah. Paul Stewart. And it was through Razzcaz that we met Paul Stewart.
Oh, okay.
You know what I'm saying? So like, that was like, I think Imani Romai and Fatlip was up in San Francisco at a Gavin convention or something like that. And they were hanging out with Razzcaz. And then they, you know, were in like, they were all in a hotel room with folks freestyling and stuff like that. And so, Imani Romai and Fatlip did, their freestyle was the song Your Mama.
Okay.
And so Paul Stewart was like, yo, that shit's mad funny. Let's get this going. Like, what do we got to do? This, that, and the
just
other.
Just based on the one
just
song.
Based on that, you know? And so you got any more stuff? Like, yeah, you know, our boy Trey is down in L.A., yada, yada, blah, blah, blah. We got back to L.A. He told me about it. We, you know, it's almost like the rest is kind of history. Because then Paul was like, I think he had Your Mama, Pass Me By, and maybe Officer or something like that.
Right.
Something real basic and simple like that to shop around. And so next thing we know, Paul's like, yo, we got this. We want to, Motown wants to take y'all to lunch. And we were just like, we didn't give a fuck. We was like, okay, let's go get lunch.
Right.
You know
free
what I
lunch,
mean?
Cool.
Because we were like, fuck, let's just go eat then. You
right.
know, we did not care.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, like, we didn't know where it was, if it was going to, like, things were going to spark off or not.
Right.
Because, like, first off, the bar was real high in the industry back then, too. You know what I mean? It was hard to get in the record industry.
Mm-hmm.
It's not as easy as it is now for folks, you know? So then it was Def Jam. And then it was another company. And then it was another company. And we was just, like, having free lunches and dinners.
Right.
And that's literally what we were thinking.
Right.
Like, shit, that was cool. Yeah. Who else is coming? Let's go eat. You know, like, and it just started picking up in the delicious vinyl and
right.
the whole deal. And the good part about all of that was of not like being super excited about all the options that we had. Like, and we had a lot of options.
Right.
Is that we got a chance to like, well, if we go here, their roster is really big and they'll put us on the shelf. Cause we did have knowledge from what Reggie Andrews taught us about like the industry and how the inner workings, and Jay Swift taught us too. And LAJ taught us as well.
Right.
About how the inner workings of the industry. And so we were able to like, man, this company's giving us a lot of money, but they're not giving us the creative control. Like Delicious Vinyls, not as much money, but has given us creative control. And then the Heavies is over there, and like, they're, you know, the Heavy Rhyme Experience album. We're gonna be on that album with all these heavy hitters. We was like,
right.
We was like, let's make this move. So we made that move.
So with Delicious Vinyl, they also had Tone Loc at the time.
They had Tone Loc.
MC.
Yep. And Tone Loc and his crew became our, you know, like our family, like strong.
Right.
Yeah.
And so how do you think Delicious Vinyl was able to really compete with the majors at the time?
They just had the right thing.
Mm-hmm.
you know, they had the right, with Tone Loc's success and, you know, Young MC's success of the songs, they had like a, they had a niche, you know what I mean? They had like a, they really had a way, it was palatable.
Okay.
You know what I mean? It was like, you know, it reached out, it actually, you know, like to look at it, it really reached out to, you know, like pop culture and like different things. So they had some arms reach, and they were, Delicious Vinyl is a creative space. Even if you look at them now with Delicious Vinyl Pizza and stuff and the things that they do and the Boom Yard and all these different things, they just get so active creatively in, I mean, like the proof is fucking really in the pudding, dude.
Right.
You look at them, it's like, they're always doing something specialty wise. They, you know, like even if it was like with Orlando with Brass, and you know, like if you really like kind of like set, you know, pull it apart a little bit.
Right.
It's like, damn, DV has always been flavorful. And then they had Pharcyde too. And we really took it like to another level.
Yeah. You guys were, you know what like I mean? Synonymous with,
man,
those guys.
We took it to another level about like creative, just creativity and just, we put it on the map. We made a mark creatively. You know what I mean? Like to know like, oh, that's a reputable company. They got Pharcyde. You know, they got, you want to hear what else they got.
But what was the most creative thing you saw Delicious Vinyl do to brand themselves? Because I always thought they were great at branding themselves, or the Pharcyde. Like, answer either one.
They have a good sense of humor.
Okay, that's important.
And they're open-minded.
Right.
And to this day, if we play some stuff for, like Jay Swift will play some stuff for Mike of what he's just, what he's been doing, or we play something that and he just gets to laughing. He's like, man, dude, that's just so crazy. That's just wild.
Right.
Let's just do that.
Right.
And you know what I mean?
He's always like that.
And we do, yeah, he's always like that. And Rick Ross is the same. You know what I mean? And they are, you know, like they just really know how to, they know their audience and they know how to feed it. So they keep branding it in the proper way. Like the Pharcyde stuff, we had the fire hydrant pissing on the dog thing.
Right.
And we went through a lot of different artists to see what kind of logo we would have. And when we got Slick and Den involved, and they came up with, we just had like a little brainstorming circle,
right?
And we would just talk about like, what if this, and what if, because that's our main thing was, what if this happened or what if that happened. We just laugh and, you know, like that whole thing, but all of our ideas, getting them out. And you know, like what if there was a roller coaster going inside, you know, a vagina and coming out the mouth. That would be crazy. And we actually did it.
Right.
You know what I mean? And someone was able to communicate that without making it look mad offensive, or, you know,
right.
Thing. But we were just like kind of sick ass kids, you know, and they communicated it well. And believe me, Slick had so many sick drawings.
Yeah.
And we were just like, man, this is crazy. Like there was just like all kinds of papers on the table, like, oh my God, because he had come back after our you know, roundtable discussion. Uh-huh. And even at that roundtable discussion, we were like, what if like there was a fire hydrant pissing on a dog? God, that shit would be mad funny. And he put it together,
right.
And that shit was like, it was just in there. And right. So we made stickers of those, and we would just have like rolls of stickers and just bombing up the streets with, you know, and people would be like, what the fuck is this?
Right.
Fire hydrant pissing on a dog. I ain't never seen no shit like that. And everybody's like laughing about it. And so that was like kind of that guerrilla style marketing to get things buzzing. Uh-huh. Was everything. And when we're on tours and on the, you know, doing our shows and stuff like that, people had heard about us. Cause when we did our shows, we were like super animated and we get like amazingly creative with, like, we would go to the store and get like mad clear masks where you could see some of the face, but it's like really creepy.
Yeah.
And so we get those masks and we would be on stage and like we have this crazy like jazzy music or whatever, and we like come out to the crowd and we're just like looking into people's faces and stuff like that, and people are like, what the fuck? And then the music starts and we just go ape shit,
right?
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And people were like, oh my God, this is the craziest shit I've ever seen. You know what I mean? And so we just kept that bar high.
Right, right.
But that was naturally us, though.
Right.
And it came from us not giving a fuck and getting rejected, you know, by all these other labels and shit. And then one day we were just like, you know what, fuck this, man.
You weren't catering to them anymore.
We just lost, you know, we lost all of that trying to be this or trying to be that, you know?
Yeah, I was going to ask you. I mean, so being from LA and what the scene was at the time,
yeah,
you guys were so out the box, you know? It was so much more creative and different than what was going on here.
Yeah.
So what were your influences at the time coming into it? Like, what influenced your style?
Man, see, like... I got this thing that I'm doing with this artist too. Mm-hmm. We were just talking about what influences you, and my manager, you know, they were talking about, Trey, we got to get your social media shit popping, you know, like we got to do something that's going to like kind of like corral your folks in. And we were talking about like, you know, what inspired you.
Right.
And so I started listening to my Pandora and I put Boogie Down Productions. So I got Boogie Down Productions radio on my Pandora, right? And it just goes through a lot of old school stuff. And I'm just listening to all of this stuff. And, you know, BDP was like one of my, that sparked me. Mm-hmm. You know, LL Cool J, that sparked me. The Message sparked me. Mm-hmm. You know, Sugar Hill when I was younger. Like, as I talk about this, it kind of, my mind opens up that picture of where I was as a young kid. You know, right. over on, you know, Rodeo Road and in La Cienega where I grew up. Mm-hmm. And what my life was like, you know, like music, my life was always filled with music, you know, and I have to go back a little bit further. So I think Sugar Hill Gang was probably like the first thing that I heard as a kid, you know, over in that area. And that was like something that was super cool that, I don't know why I liked it, but I just did, mm-hmm. you know, because what was in my like youth soundtrack was either Rick James, you know, like that type of stuff, yeah. or Parliament, you know, One Nation Under the Groove, you know, Knee Deep and all that stuff. That was like, that was your life. That described who you were. Like everything you felt. I feel that song. I feel those songs.
Right.
That's like me. That's like if you let blood drip out of my, you know, out of my veins onto the ground, it'd be like musical notes. That was Parliament.
Right.
You know what I mean? Like, oh shit, that's Parliament.
Yeah.
Ready or not, here we come. Getting down.
Or you know, and those were the things, or you know, you would have, or Quincy Jones, I Know Kavita was like this song that just like, I couldn't stop trying to figure that shit out in my head as a kid.
Uh-huh.
Like, it was like some galactic outer space something. And I just kind of like, my mind and my soul just opened up to it. Mm-hmm. And that's the cool thing about what music used to do for you.
Right.
That it kind of don't do now. Like, yeah. you don't get dreamy like that.
Right, right.
You don't like lose yourself in thought.
Yeah.
You just don't. Or it doesn't heal you anymore. You know what I mean? Like,
it's so formulaic now.
It's so crazy, you know. And the rap that was created back then had those elements that, because even the rappers, like NWA, they knew, like when I went to go see Straight Outta Compton,
uh-huh.
I was like, oh my God, I forgot all the super dope ass hits that they had.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
They were on it.
Yeah.
They were never off.
Right.
They were never off.
Yeah, it's crazy.
And, you know, they were cut from the same cloth musically because we all grew up with the same elements, the Parliament, the Rick James, you know, and those were soulful things for us, man.
Right, right.
And it did something to our souls.
Right, right. And then moving forward a few years, you guys were really the first people to I guess, give J Dilla a shot, or JD.
Yeah, 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 definitely.
How did that come about?
Well, so we produced a lot of stuff on our own, uh-huh. myself and Booty Brown and Fat Lip. We did a bunch of stuff, and we got to a point where we like had to sit down and listen to where we were at. Mm-hmm. And so as we were sitting down listening to where we're at, we were like, we still need something.
Right.
You know, and what we always wanted was, we were always into East Coast music. you know, Pete Rock, you know, Brand Nubians, De La Soul. I should have said that first.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Yeah. A Tribe Called Quest.
Yeah.
Leaders of the New School. Like, the list kind of goes on. You know what I mean? And forgive me. Oh, Diamond D. I cannot forget Diamond D.
Yeah.
You know? So there's just different, things. And we were just like, you know what? We got to go. We need to talk to Tip. So we talked to Q-Tip, and Q-Tip was like, yeah, man, y'all should come out to New York for a little bit. And we talked to Diamond D.
Mm-hmm.
And this cat, there was a cat named Gingy Brown out in New York. There was a couple cats out there, you know. I was hanging out. I was just hanging out in New York, man.
Yeah.
So we went out there for like 6 months. And we worked, we were trying to work with Q-Tip, but Q-Tip was busy on working with the Mobb Deep record.
Oh, okay.
And so he was like, yo, man, I don't want to let y'all down, man. He's like, I got this cat that I want y'all to check out. So y'all, you know, come to my crib and we'll listen to some beats and stuff like that. And we'll get it together. And was like, all right, cool. So we go over to his spot. And he has this like cassette tape or some shit like that. And he's just playing like snippets, like real short ass snippets of beats. And like the song Bullshit, you know, you hear that. You hear that.
Yeah.
And it just takes you. It gets you galactic, right?
Right.
So there's that. And then you hear for Runnin.
Yeah.
And you're like, oh my God.
So he had all that.
Oh, he had all of that.
It was already done.
Oh my God. This guy.
That's crazy.
He had everything. It was like, okay. And so we didn't meet JD then.
Right.
And so we was like, oh my God, this is cool. So we get back to our little spot and shit. And we're like, JD. It's like, man, ain't no JD. You know what I mean? We thought Tip was fucking with us because, you know, it was like Jonathan Davis is, you know.
Oh,
We thought it was like his other little low-key shit. And then one day, I think we were on Houston or something like that down in Soho. And lo and behold, we see this guy and he's got his little Kango hat on, looking like J Dilla, you know.
Right.
Looking like JD, because that's what we used to call him, JD.
Yeah.
And met him. He was a cool cat. And shit, man, the rest is kind of history. I have to wrap it up like that. You know what I mean?
Because
we did a lot of stuff and recording and things like that. And then JD came down to Los Angeles to mix a lot of, you know, to mix it all.
Right.
But those were missing parts in our the puzzle of Lab Cabin California.
Right, right.
You know what I mean? So that was the icing on the cake. We needed JD.
Yeah.
To help push that shit, you know?
Not to cut you off, but I had a crazy story I needed to tell you.
Oh, okay.
From when I was in college was when that came out. I was a freshman in college.
Yeah.
And I drank a bottle of Robitussin one night. Stupid college shit, you know?
Uh-huh.
And I fell asleep watching the drop video. So I was watching it and I'm still kind of like towards the end of my hallucination and I wake up from my dream and I'd been dreaming backwards the whole
time. Wow. Okay.
So that video set me off into this whole backwards dream and it was crazy. Like I woke up, like it was definitely one of those experiences. But I think one of the things about Drop was it was just like, it was such a perfect example of your creativity. And that you guys were willing to step out of the box and do something new and take chances, really.
Yeah, yeah.
Why do you think artists, I would almost say for the last 15 years in their videos, for the most part, don't take creative chances like that? It's like the same people looking hard and surrounded by girls and nice cars and all that.
I say it all depends because, I always said that our ideas and our imagination is expensive.
Mm-hmm.
So a lot of stuff could be budgetary. You know what I mean? Like folks are just trying to do what they can, like especially like now, because when a record company used to spend money on a video, it's like you had a whole gamut of really good film guys that can do what they say that's on the treatment.
Mm-hmm.
And believe me, I was a fucking stickler about, I see what I'm reading, but can we pull this off? Right. What's it going to take to pull this off? You know, like, I think Other Fish was a video that cost probably like 70 grand. Back when 70 grand was like 70 grand.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, now 70 grand is like, oh, $7,000. But, you know, it's to pull off, and certain things we didn't pull off as like we wanted to, but we tried, and we had, at least we had a budget to try. Mm-hmm. You know, but even still, I think it could have been, you know, it could have been, I wish we could have got the underwater part a lot better and clear. Like, it was just, how can we, and then technology probably wasn't even there now. Right. Technology is at a, there's so many factors now that you can have like a super video, and the shit that we were doing back then and that film was doing back then, like Star Wars fucking instance.
Right.
They didn't have the technology that they have now. And they were doing some amazing shit, you know what I mean? Or some cool, super cool stuff. So, you know, like Passin Me By was our first, you know, when we were upside down type right. situation. And then Drop was another situation where that got pulled off pretty well. Because we sat and we talked about it with Spike Jonze and just had everything. He's like, yeah, man, I want you guys to go backwards and learn the words backwards. And we're going to do everything backwards. And, you know, and then we just started brainstorming. I was like, yeah, what if we unpaint a painting, or, yeah. you know, got the dog walking a dog, or, you know, dog man in a dog suit walking a dog, and the balls bouncing up the stairs. And
right.
we would just come with all things that could work, that would look good for, you know, for the camera.
Yeah.
And we had, you know, we had a budget to do it. Mm-hmm. So I think, you know, there could be a struggle creatively because of the budget alone. You know what I mean? People don't have money to, like, get, you know, some CGI shit or whatever. Like, I'm sure, like, and then I don't know where people's imagination is and creativity. And right. then you also in a group. And one guy might want one thing. And another guy's like, no, let's just keep it simple. And it's just like, ah, you're fucking with me right now. You know what I mean? Because you really want to get your shit off. One thing I like about, like, Kanye's video, where it was a long video with the angel in it and stuff like that, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Is that he pulled off his creative, whatever's going on with him creatively, and that was a complete thought. And I appreciate shit like that, you know what I mean? When folks can do that.
Right.
Or I appreciate when folks don't have a budget whatsoever and they pull off some shit.
Right.
You know, like they go to these film schools and they look at the kids' reels and see, like, damn, how did you do that? He's like, oh, I was just doing this and fucking around with that. We want you. Yeah. You know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
And yeah, it's like, and I didn't even use a lot of money. Right. And it's like, you know, you just have to kind of dive in sometimes and see what can be done. And I always, like, when I talk to my students in my, when I'm doing my little seminars for hip hop and shit for kids and shit that are aspiring.
Right.
To do what we do, I always tell them, like, see what all the things that you can do with no money first.
It's great advice.
Before you start adding money to it. You know, and then, right. you know, and that's just the smartest thing. All these things. And then you know where, you know, because you don't want to burn through money. Right. You want it to work for you. You know what I mean? You want it just like, okay, so we need that for post.
Yeah.
Like all this shit, like, I know it looks like crap, guys. I know it looks like crap. But when we get to post, let's take all this money and put it toward post. And then we sweetening all this shit up, and then you look at it like, damn.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And then sometimes, you know, sometimes the simple things are the best things, you know?
It's true.
So that's how I look at it. You know, like I look at either it had to be budgetary, why people shit is not as good as it could be. Because if you don't have a budget, your imagination is limited.
Right.
You know what I mean? Because the way I look at shit, I look at how my dreams look. I want shit to look just like my dreams. Just like Madonna. She had this one video years ago, and it was just crazy. Mm-hmm. And it looked really dreamy. Or the movie The Cell.
Yeah.
I was like, that's how I want my fucking videos.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Like, because that's just how I like saturations. I like all kind of shit, man. I like wardrobe. I like, you know, when it comes, so that's another side of me,
right?
Completely, that's just in me.
You know what I mean? As like, I'm an MC and I'm a DJ and I'm a producer, but I also take pictures and I also like art. And, you know, I'm a well-rounded dude like that. Mm-hmm. And so is Romai. And so is Fat Lip. And so is, you know, Imani. And so is Delicious Vinyl. And that's why the fuck we worked so well.
Right.
You know what I mean? Like, that's why that whole shit worked.
Yeah.
It's because we can allow our minds to go, yeah. And J Swift is the same. All like our crew in LAJ, I'm not gonna leave nobody out. Why? Right. Because it takes all of these open minded, when it comes down to it, despite any of our shit that people may read about and it's going on or not going on or whatever, that crew of that circle of people, they were the perfect motherfuckers for us to win.
Right. Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
All of them.
Yeah.
The whole, like, the list goes on. Leslie Cooney. I feel like I'm at an award show winning a Grammy right now. And you just go, the list goes on.
Right.
Eric Serafin, Hollywood Sound itself, all the people that are a part of it, because these are all looking at the same goal as far as what the Pharcyde thing is.
Right. Right.
You know?
Yeah.
People jump in like, oh my God, I can do whatever.
Right.
I can experiment on this. Hey guys, what do you think about this? I don't know. Tell us more about it. Oh wow, that sounds crazy. Can you pull it off? You can? How much is it gonna cost? Or it is? Or how much more did you need? All right, okay, well fuck, we don't have it, but how can we do it? You know, and it's like you need that. There shouldn't be can't in your mind.
Right, right.
Because it gets in the way of the music, gets in the way of the art.
Right. Well, I think the fact that you guys were somewhat independent too. I mean, being with Delicious Vinyl, and it seems like you've carried that mentality over to your own solo stuff and stuff with Trademark and everything you're doing. It's beneficial in that sense that you can be creative. You don't have some suits trying to like put in their two cents when they don't know what they're talking about, basically.
You know, and speaking of the suits, you know, I rather them give me their honest opinion, because this is like, some things are political. Mm-hmm. I don't want politics in my shit.
Right.
Like, you guys go do that shit somewhere else.
Mm-hmm.
When it comes to music and art and stuff that, you know, like, let's make the best art. We're here at this table. If you're not, my grandmother always says, if you can't say something positive, do something positive, then don't say anything at all.
Mm-hmm.
And I want these execs that are just the bean counters, you guys need to step back.
Right.
Just so we can, you know, so you can have something that we're not building something that's just going to, I mean, if it does well and blows up right now, fine. But the things that we're making are timeless.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, it's like a Rolls Royce.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? It's like those things that are, you know, like handcrafted. I'm handcrafted. We're handcrafted. And all that other speed shit, it winds up being that way. Right. And so what you like, I want our music industry back of how it was when they were making a Fleetwood Mac, or they were making a, you know, Pink Floyd, or, you know, like, that's what we need, or Tool, or, you know, we just need that as a culture.
Yeah. Well, we were talking a little bit before we were on air about how people would put actual time into making music, and you'd have that year or two off to just work on the album.
Yes.
And now it's like it has to be put out one after the other.
And it suffers, bro.
Yeah. People's attention span, and it's partly because of the oversaturation, but kids' attention span is just gone. You know?
But when they, and I get that, because my attention span can do that too.
Right.
But what is pleasant is a moment of clarity.
That's definitely true.
You know, and that moment of clarity is like a, you know, maybe a Earth, Wind & Fire song.
Mm-hmm.
Or maybe it's, I told my friend Austin Antoine, who's, you know, in a Trademark crew with us and in Bizarre Ride crew with us too. He's like, yo, man, Trey, what do you listen to? You know, he's like, sometimes I don't even listen to rap music. I was like, me neither. I was like, sometimes I'm listening to meditation music. I'm listening to old 1930s music, or I'm listening to things that don't make my mind, don't jumble my mind.
Right.
Like the world jumbles your mind, and I need to, for peace to happen. So I can, what I'm doing is unraveling all the gunk in my head so I can get to that creative space again. Because it's not, it doesn't, it, when you're like in that mode, that tight mode, it doesn't release what you need.
Right.
And you can't, like, I want to be the type of dude that, what was super impressive, and I keep going back to Star Wars, is, you know, Star Wars, that's impressive. Mm-hmm. That a man started from one story and is still going.
Yeah.
Like, first we were in his imagination, and now we're in his team's imagination, and so on and so forth, and so on and so on. And they just keep going and going, and it's like that type of, you know, I think that shit was super brilliant.
Right.
Or any campaign of, like, Star Trek, can't forget that.
Right, right.
Any of that type of stuff that really, like, took a lot to think about.
Yeah, yeah.
And you needed that. You can't be rushed by money about that. You know, it's like that is something that's going to educate us in one sense, you know, as humanity, you know, and lift us up, make us, it's going to do what it's supposed to do. Like, I like spiritual things because, and I'm not talking religious because I don't do the religious thing, but the spiritual things really help us to reconnect. Mm-hmm. with all of us, with source and with all of us, and that creative thing that we actually need, you know what I mean, to actually elevate and become a new, the next thing, to evolve, you know?
Yeah. I was going to ask you, do you have like a specific meditation routine that you do?
Yeah, I teach meditation too. Oh, and I have, like, in Portland, I usually have my, like, meditation circles that I do. And I think I have a few things in the works that I'm going to do as far as that's concerned too.
That's great.
You know, because clarity is everything. And because clarity helps you to know what your next step is going to be. You know what I mean?
Right.
Like when I sat with students at MI, when I taught there, I would listen to students' music and stuff like that. And I can hear where the band was arguing in a song.
Yeah.
I can hear, like, why did that happen? Or, you know, you got the people that they just try to put some shit on there just to be on the song because it's a hot thing. It's like, no, you don't do that.
Right.
You step back, we pull that all off, and let's really, like, we're coloring this what it's supposed to be. So that means that you're not even listening to the spirit and the energy and the cosmos.
Right.
You trying to be, you know, you trying to put a shit on a sandwich.
Is it Thoreau that said simplify? I think that's one of the things. I mean, a lot of times, even when I listen to the radio, it's just so bright and so they pack so much into it. It doesn't give you that room to breathe.
It's nothing, bro.
Yeah.
It's absolutely nothing. Like, because how do you feel? Is it memorable? Like, is it memorable? Do, like down the line, do you, like, have that song in your head and remind you of when you were a kid type of thing? Like,
it's crazy.
Does it make you grow? You know what I mean?
Yeah, I've been reading about when Hey Ya came out by Outkast, right?
Yep.
So they were putting songs, and they still do, obviously, but they put songs through algorithms to see what the popularity, if they can guess what's going to be popular on the radio. And so Hey Ya came, they put it through the algorithm, and it hit, like, it was like record level of, this is going to be the most popular song ever because it had, you know, it's so catchy and everything was so dope. They put it out there and it wasn't biting. People were changing the channel within 30 seconds.
What?
Yeah. Like, most people were changing the channel. So they were trying to figure out, like, okay, how are we going to get this to catch? So they started sandwiching it between familiar songs.
Okay.
And that way people were staying tuned, and eventually that became familiar. But what they learned from that was that it was actually the familiarity factor that they weren't taking into account. So even if songs that are on commercial radio, they have to sound like the stuff that's come before it.
Okay.
And if they're too out there, people are just, they're not used to that. And that comes from the part of the brain that's, you know, goes way back to, like, you know, just being protective of what's its surroundings and only paying attention to the things that are either going to catch your attention because you're interested or because you're basically you're protecting yourself from, you know, a bear that's going to attack you or whatever.
Yeah.
And so, you know, moving forward, people have to have that familiarity or else they just, they zone out. They're not there.
Yeah.
It's not, it's crazy. Like,
yeah. Like people are like, damn, what is that?
Yeah.
You know?
So they've turned this into a science, you know, yeah. Which is the opposite of being creative or
manipulation.
Artistic. Yeah, it's a bunch of bullshit. But I thought that was interesting just reading how that came about. Because then that song became like, you know, played. Now it's still probably played at all the weddings and everything, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's interesting. Like, as you said it, you know, intuitively, I'm like, what do I feel about it? You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And it makes me feel, you know, like happy and you know, like for the moment. You know what I mean?
Right.
And then I think about, like, I go back to once again. So that's, it's good that you said that for sure, because as a DJ,
right,
in our crowds, I got to think about that.
Mm-hmm.
It, you know?
You do.
And if I threw Hey Ya on, there would have to be a day party for me. And, you know, but when, I know when I throw it on, folks are going to right. lose their shit about it because it's just going to be, it's like, lose your shit. You know, but it's, when you're saying they have to sandwich this between that, it's, how you have to DJ as at the same time too, like, cause you're looking through your set and what you got and you're looking at your party and where it is. Right. And let's say somebody has a special request. I'll say that.
Right.
And they're like, yo, you got blah, blah, blah. And I'm like, yeah, I do. And it is a cool song. That's just dope. But we're in this mode. Do you see? Cause they're not thinking about the mode. They're just thinking about what they don't want.
Care.
So when you look at the vibe and it's like, we'll get to that. Cause I got to ramp it up
right.
to even get it to your song, or I got to ramp it down.
They don't get beats per minute. They don't understand
all of that stuff. Or the zone.
Right. Right.
Just the conscious bubble of the crowd.
Right.
You know what I mean? And it's like,
you could play that song they want and clear the dance floor, and then they're just
it
like...
Would, oh, my God, there's things that would clear the dance floor. That happened to me once, and that was a beautiful thing, because like I was like, oh, okay. Because like sometimes I like it. I was like, so I'll hit them with this. Bam. And right. then you see everybody run back to the dance. Ooh, that's my song, girl. Like, shit, I thought you was tired and your feet was hurting.
Right, right.
But I dropped that, and now you running down to the thing because you got some more twerk to do. We're going in.
Yeah, I've DJed. I mean, I don't DJ as much anymore, but I DJed for 20 years. And when someone comes to request a song and then they're just like, they'll leave by the time you play it because you do have to get to that point. And then they'll come back and request it again. You'll be like, I just played that 5 minutes ago. I just played it.
Where were you at?
Oh, yeah. I was smoking.
Like,
play it again.
Yeah.
Like, they're that concerned with themselves that they don't care that other people have to hear that song again 5 minutes
Boom.
Later.
Yeah. Boom. You said it right there.
Yeah.
My friend, DJ Adam 12, he said when people come up to him, he has this little paper with a little map. And it's like, you are here. And then it has to the other party. It's like, where you can go there. You know what I mean? Or, that's, you know, I got DJ friends that are like, you know, we're like, what I tell them, I was like, you know, go listen to that shit in your car.
Right. Yeah. I mean, they probably did on the way to the club.
Right.
Like they need to hear it again 10 minutes later.
It's like, look, man, this is my job. You fucking with my thing. I got this.
Right.
All you got to do is dance. I'll get you. You're going to have a good time.
Right.
You know
right.
what I mean? It's so funny, man.
So I was going to ask you, since you obviously been DJing for a while and with music and everything you're doing, what are your sources of income right now?
My sources of income is, you know, luckily, residuals, royalties, and touring.
Mm-hmm. Those are the most important.
Yeah, touring. Because, like, this is what I wish the industry was some parts of how it was, but not all parts of how it was.
Right.
Because, you know, this is how we make a living. You know, just like the film industry, they locked their shit down. The film industry, I think they tried to get on it as much as they could, but they fared a lot better than we did in the music industry, I feel like. You know what I mean?
Definitely.
Because, you know, let's go back to the video thing. For a company to give you 20, let's say 20,000, because, you know, 200,000 is probably way out of the question, you right. know what I mean? But, you know, if they give you 20,000, like, what's the rate of return for the money that they put out? How many records do they have to sell to, you know, to
you know, get that back. And that's just business on how do we stay afloat type shit, you know?
Right.
And it's like, I get it. And I don't get mad at, you know, companies, because like, we're all trying to make the biggest impact and step forward for that to like be something that's workable. And that's just here in the States. Now, mm-hmm. overseas, you know, like folks can press up some vinyl or maybe down in South, you know, Central America or whatever, where people buy CDs, you know, or those places where they buy CDs still.
Mm-hmm.
Or like, let's say in the country music area, things, people are still supportive. They want to buy your CD. They want to,
right.
you know, they want that tangible paraphernalia, which is, that's it. Oh my God. That was a good part of music, when you can, like, you got the record, you open,
it was the best.
You fold open the fucking record and you look at like the liner notes and who produced this. And then you look at the artwork and like, it just gives you another, look at that particular artist and how they think and what they're about. And the, like, you know, cause if we didn't have like the Bizarre Right picture on there,
if you didn't, yeah,
you don't know who the fuck we were. If we had like if we was all dressed in suits and said, like, that would not be the same
but experience. That was so iconic, you. The cover of that
it
album.
Was,
it was,
man,
like everyone
you.
Knew that. I
yes,
mean,
yes.
Yeah, you're right. You wouldn't have broke the same way today. No.
And you wanted to know more.
Yeah.
You wanted to dig in more. I was like, man, sometimes some parts of me was like, I hate that we, like for our second album, I hate that we showed our faces on that.
Mm.
We could have did something for Lab Cabin California. It was different, but it's you know, it's fine. It's what it was, because we had to, like, people wanted to know, like, you know, we don't know what the fuck they look like.
Well, were you able to sneak under the radar in the public at that point? Like even after Passin Me By had come out, or that video kind of made you more.
Yeah, the video, like the video was a thing that, you know, it's so funny, man. I mean, people recognize this and shit. Like, people recognize me more with dreads. Because when they see me without dreads, they don't know who the fuck I am, you know? Like, what happened to the dude with dreads? Me? Oh, shit, that is you. Oh. You know?
Yeah. Do you miss any of that? Like just the stardom where it's just like people, you know?
It's still there.
Yeah, yeah.
It's still there. I'm super low-key, dude.
No, I know.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
You are. You
I
know,
you know. That's, I appreciate that. That's, honestly, that's one of the things I really appreciate about you, because I see you and I've, you know, some of the other artists I work with as well. And I could say De La Soul or yeah. another group of people that have never like put themselves above the people around them. Like
yeah.
you could just see you chilling in a crowd. You're not going to treat anyone like they're less than you.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
I got a lot of respect for that. Cause
thanks, man.
Yeah. I've been around enough people that
yeah.
they think they're just, you know, their head's way too inflated.
One thing, like I'm this way now. I don't know where I'm gonna be tomorrow. and good. I say that in the most positive way, because I have friends that are, you know, like extremely popular. And I just remember going out, you know, like just on simple shit. We went to the movies or we're going to dinner or some shit like that. And, you know, and people like approach them on some bullshit, just fucking with them. And it's
right.
like, man, I'm going to whip your ass, man. I am not, you know, like, yeah. I'll fuck you up. You know what I mean? Fuck
yeah.
that. And you can't do that though. You know, it's just like so much shit. And I used to look at my homeboy and I'm like, man, I hate when they, you know, folks come at you like that. He's the kindest dude, such
right.
a generous and loving person and stuff like that. And here comes this fucking douchebag, you know, douchebag crew.
Right.
You know,
right.
I mean, like, oh, no, no. You know, my boy will fuck you up too. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, there's just plenty of times where we're like, all right, dude, look. There's this one guy, I was like, listen, we're going to go to this alley over here, and we're going to handle all this shit that you're talking about. You know what I mean? And this girl, she had to come in like, no, we're good. Everything's good. Everything's
yeah.
good. It's like, all right, we're going to make sure it's all good, though. You know what I mean? We're going to handle whatever was going on with you and my homeboy.
Right.
Straight up.
Right.
You know what I mean? Because you think it's funny. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
But we can go, like, take as long as you want.
That's the one thing I think being a celebrity or being someone who gets noticed a lot is like, I think people don't take them into account as a person. And a lot of times, like, they just disregard that. It's
they got families.
Right, right.
They're a person. They're
right.
they're eating.
Right. And they're judging their whole opinion on the one person.
What they saw.
A 10 second interaction, they're going to go tell all their friends, oh, he was a dick because he wouldn't talk to me. He, you know, it's like you could have just had like someone in your family could have just died, you know, like
anything,
anything. You could just be having a bad day. Do you have to always put on a smile and shake everyone's hand?
Yeah.
I mean, they expect it.
Yeah.
You know,
it's cool. I think it's all in the person too. Cause like sometimes I'll be like, man, like even like when he has his moments where he's like being like, just being a dick, you know, like, dude, you can't do that. You know what I mean? Or whatever.
Right.
And, but now, you know, when I'm out and about, like I just handle people how they handle whatever energy you giving me, like either I'm a kind of like, if you're being a dick, I'm going to do others. I'm going to go another way.
Right.
You know, if you try to persist in being a dick, I got a bodyguard.
Right.
Like, or I'm very direct with people. So I'm like, yo, what's up? You know, like, and just really like getting into like, you diffuse that shit. Like, what's up? What do you need? Or what's going on? You know what I mean?
Right.
Because if you on some bullshit, you're going to be bullshit. But if you're not, we're going to sit down. We're going to have a cool conversation. Like, it's all that what you want in this moment.
Right.
Because they're all like anybody. That's anybody with anybody.
Yeah.
What are you going to do in this moment that you have with this person that can be just an angel?
Yeah.
Of a person.
Right.
You know what I mean? Like, man, and then you guys created, like, maybe this person was a brilliant writer, but we would have never gotten to that if he was just a drunk dick.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
But, like, all was cool. We sat down. Oh, you do that? Damn, I didn't know that. Man, that's pretty fresh. Hey, let me make a call. Or, like, just different things.
Yeah, you just never know.
No matter what level you at, even if you're an heir to whatever, you know, I don't give a fuck about, like, people's status at all. And in Pharcyde, we did not give a shit about people's status, bro. Right. And I think that was another reason why we were able to connect with the people that we did, be in alignment with the De La Souls or the Tribe Called Quest and shit, because we, like, I felt like we was all cousins.
Right. And so, I mean, when you have artists come up to you, just kind of getting back to the interactions, and they're wanting to get your attention, or they want you to check out their music or whatever, how do you recommend they approach you?
Man, I don't know. That's a good question, bro. That's a good question, because sometimes when people give me their stuff, I might be in writing mode.
Right.
And I probably don't want to hear something for 3-4 months because I'm focusing on a project and a certain thing. And then, but when I get to it, I'm like, damn, and this shit is pretty fucking hot and fire. Like, right. I got this kid, you know, he's a super dope kid that's in London. He always sends me stuff all the time. And I'm like, all right, he's like, keep in mind, man. I'm like, thank you for sending me all this stuff. But keep in mind, I'm pretty busy. But when I get to it, I get to it. So I did the song with him.
Uh-huh.
And I sent it back, and that shit was flavor.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? It's like, I'm just letting him know. Like, I haven't stopped thinking about what you do. And I can't wait to, like, click through all the fucking emails that I have of him with beat snippets, because I'm interested. And there's a place for it.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? There's a place for it, or a project for it, because I know a lot of artists, and I'm more like you can call me an A&R kind of guy.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? I would do great as an A&R somewhere. You know what I mean? Because I know where shit goes.
Right.
You know what I mean? It's like, you know, like, it's like musical laundry just sitting on a thing, but it's like, oh shit, I know that shirt can go over there. Well, that man, blah, 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 could rock that.
Right.
And then you bring them together. Yeah. That's a great outfit. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And,
yeah.
I, you know, so that's just how I work.
Yeah, and you mentioned you've taken Dylan Cooper under your wing, right?
Well, Dylan Cooper, like, he's cutting his own way through.
He's
a busy cat, you know. And Dylan Cooper and K Natural, my bandmate in Bizarre Ride, they're homies.
Yeah,
you
yeah.
know what I mean?
Yeah, K Nat mentioned him.
Yeah. So I just dropped Dylan off at the airport today because we had him on the Trademark record.
Okay.
Which is super, you know, he came in, he's got like, he's like one of them kids that got them ideas. He's like, yo, Trey, yo, check this out. I got this verse, and I see what you think about it, or, you know, like, and that kind of synergy. And that shit is really cool, you know?
Right.
And then to have him with Austin Antoine, who's a super, super monster when it comes to freestyling. I think he was in the Guinness Book of World Records too, you know, mm-hmm. with the longest freestyle, one of the longest freestyles as well. And also just
him as a writer and where his head is at. And he's a young cat. He's like maybe 24 or some shit like that.
Right,
so all these young cats. And it's really cool to see these young cats and where they're at.
Right.
In a good way. Because we were always talking about, where things are right now and what the content of what people are talking about.
Mm-hmm.
And these guys are, they're pretty top notch on their thing. So Dylan Cooper is, he's making his own waves, but I was glad to have him a part of our shit because he's connected with my boy from, you know, K-Nat from Bizarre Ride. And,
right.
You know, and K-Nat's like, he's like little intel. I call him intel because he knows what's up, who's hot, what's going on, what happened with this battle or that. And Fatlip was like kind of that way too.
Yeah. And, well, K-Nat has all the, he knows all where all the drums are. And
dude.
His tech.
He's techie.
Yeah.
You know.
Because I've had this conversation and when I was in New York, I was at Evil D's and he's like,
okay,
do you know K-Nat? And I was like, yeah, yeah. And he was like, you got to talk to him, like, just find out where all the drums are and all of the sounds. And
I
went over there, actually, and sat with him.
Okay.
Yeah, he definitely is knowledgeable.
Or he would know the new devices, because he's a computer.
Right.
He's a computer nerd.
Yeah, yeah.
He's a geek, man.
Yeah.
And he's got his geek crew.
Yeah, yeah, he's so a good dude.
He's intel. He's like, yo, we got a show in this one. So you know what, up in this city, we doing pretty well because I looked at the stats and it's just been playing on the radio. So you know it's going to be packed tonight.
Right,
you know what I mean? Because he's like intel. He just, and I'm like, I love that you're a part, that you do that.
Right, right.
You know what I mean?
Yeah. So,
and I think Dylan Cooper might be slightly intel also.
Oh, okay. So,
I'm feeling them out, man. They cool.
So with some of the younger dudes like that you have taken under your wing, what's one piece of advice that you make sure to teach these guys?
Stay creative. Like they really teach, like Newmark was saying, he's like, we were both saying like, man, they're pretty much teaching us in some ways about, cause they're open and free with their creativity.
Mm.
Like, I don't want to stop that little, where are they going with it?
Right.
They take their, in their own little zone, you know? And, they're just in their own zone, man.
Right.
You know? And it'd be good if, here's what I say with those kids, you know, you can't do this alone. You're gonna need a team. So start building your team. This is what I tell the guys that I teach when I'm doing my, you know, hip hop classes.
Right.
Build your team. Look around you. Does your sister do social media stuff, or is she or this person an artist in here, or who does, like, figure out all these parts because you can't do it all yourself. You're gonna burn out and get tired.
Yeah, that's right. But
and you got a team that's with you that you guys are. We all have the same vision at the end result, and we all trying to make each other. We're all trying to help each other to eat and be, you know, like my crew, my big thing is like, I want to see all of my boys and have their own house.
Mm-hmm.
So we don't have to think about, you know, like you got your own house, your rent's paid, your mortgage is paid, blah, 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 so we can focus on the fucking music and create, you know what I mean?
Right.
Like y'all
you
good.
Have to worry
you
about good.
You ain't
got to
worry
job,
about that.
Like, yeah.
Dude, man. I think I'm built to be a millionaire or a billionaire dude because, you know, it's just you want all of that shit away from your mind.
Right.
So you can focus on like this well-crafted table that we're on or just, you know, or interior design or all these different things. You can't do that with a jumbled mind.
Right.
And so therefore, I'm telling my crew, I'm like I want to see all my boys just we're good. Your
right.
your home life is good, and we circle back. What's going on at home? Is everything good? How's your kid? You know, what's up with the school? You know, da, da, da. Because we do care,
right?
You know, or it's like, oh, I'm having some. This is going down. It's like, all right, well, let's get him out of that rut so that we don't have to think about that rut. I don't want you tripping about that rut, nigga. I need you here, doing this,
right?
You know, so if everybody had their teams, and when you look around, everybody in your team is good. You know, we got our film guy. I want to make sure my film guy is good. We got our crew. Like when we jump overseas, I want to make sure that all of my, you know, got my folks, we ready to go. We ready to go and take advantage of this opportunity to film as much as we can, document as much as we can. And the departments of your team have to be like a well-oiled machine.
Right, right.
Like my film section, if he said that he needs to bring on this other person to, you know, to help with this thing, and okay, who is it? Is it cool? Is it that? Because this on, you know, that's you. That's your department.
Right.
All right, cool. Is it because it's going to make the bigger picture look great?
Mm-hmm.
That's what's up.
Right.
You know what I mean? On the music end, on the beats end, like please don't send beats to me. Send them to LAJ. Because he's going to go through them like, this was nice. So this was cool. This is the sound of where we're going. Why? Because he does that shit so well. He knows about what it is that we're trying to achieve for Bizarre Ride.
Right.
There is a sound for it.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know what I mean? And we don't, like, I'd rather just focus on what we're doing to make this, you know, this, to do this, to make this shot happen.
Right.
You know what I mean? And that's why... The components, bro, or the components, ladies and gentlemen out there in the world.
Yeah.
Because this is how you need your team.
Uh-huh.
And I always say this, all your horses on your carriage have to be facing forward for them to go in the forward direction.
Right.
If your horses are going in a different direction, the carriage don't move at all. Hmm. So you gotta go check out each horse to see, you know, where their head's at. If that horse ain't working, you might need to put another horse on there that is going the same way are you doing.
Right.
Or just, you know, or figure out what it is. So you needed that handle. Okay, you're distracted because shit at home ain't good. All right, here we go. Boom, boom, boom. That's cool. That horse is facing forward now.
Mm.
Or, you know, maybe there's some dissension between, you know, this person and that person. Okay, well, what is it?
Mm.
Well, he did this and he ain't never, like... You know, whatever that situation is, okay, so let's fix that. We iron it out. Now that horse is going to, you know, we're moving forward.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And those are like honest conversations that a team has to have. Y'all have to sit at the table and like hash all this shit out so y'all can win.
Right.
You know what I mean? And winning doesn't mean like, winning to me means longevity, bro. Yeah. Winning to me is like putting out a timeless product. Winning to me is like, we're all good. Our kids are good. You know, like we want to take 3 months off.
Yeah.
As a crew, because we want to go on vacations. And then when we come back, because when we're on and everybody should be on because you had your vacation, but now we're back on and we need all heads in.
Right, right.
You know what I mean?
Yeah. I mean, that's for me, that's part of really why I started this podcast was to dive into what makes a successful person, like, what do they do differently? Yeah. What are their, you know, their habits? And, you know, it's obvious that you've run a business for all these years. It's,
yeah.
it's not just like you're an artist, but you're handling so many different arms and you've yeah. obviously worked with so many successful people and been able to, you know, pick their brain as
yeah.
well.
Yeah, absolutely.
Who's the most successful person you personally know?
I know a lot of them.
Mm-hmm.
I'll just say, like, you know, Korn, that crew.
Mm-hmm.
And I really do listen to the advice that have come from those that have done it bigger than me.
Right.
Or done it better than me. Always, you know, Pharcyde, we've always took advice and listened to Be Real.
Okay.
From Cyprus.
What's the most important thing he's taught you?
Either? Oh, so many things, man. So many things, yeah. You know? I can't put one right in front of me just now, because there's like De La Soul was another, like there's just so many folks that were influential. Here's what I learned from De La Soul.
Okay.
Is, you know, sticking together.
Hmm.
Like stick together.
It's incredible after all those years.
Dude, they are still together.
Yeah.
You know, and they don't like, they know what it is. They know like this is a day law thing. And, you know, and sometimes Mace, you know, he DJs here, or he DJs in different places or whatever, or folks might have different things. But when it comes to the De La Soul, they come together for the De La Soul things and they're moving forward about it. You know, they know what this is as a business. They know what this is as what our fans need, because it's about our fans. It's not about. Us, it's about what we're giving to the fans.
Mm.
You know what I mean? Because the fans are the ones that, you know, they hurt at the end of the day. You know what I'm saying? It's like we're not tending to our garden.
Right.
We're not giving we ain't giving no water to the garden, bro.
Right.
Like Pharcyde, for instance, it could be lush.
Right. It could be.
It could be lush because we're given to the garden, you know. But like, there's some parts that are like a little desert or whatever, you know, like just fragments of. I think, you know, like without saying anything negative, right. You know, it's just like I think cosmically the story is being written about what we are. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean?
I agree, yeah.
And it's like there's contrast in our story. There's like it's something that you could that would be actually be a story worth looking at because of the good times and the hard times and all that stuff. And you know, and shit, I don't like the hard times. And I really love my bros and all these different things. Right. You know what I mean? But at the same time, I respect what the universe is doing.
Yeah, yeah.
And I have faith that all things will lay out as it's supposed to. You know what I mean? I don't have to say like another negative word.
No. I don't think you did.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
Because I try to just look at it.
Yeah, yeah.
Like I'm a part of something amazing.
Yeah, and you give credit to everyone that's like, who was a part of it.
Man, that's when it's like man, it's just like getting like one of them like a soldier getting like one of them badges, them, yeah. You know. And shit's like really good, and we've done such a great thing, man.
Right?
You know what I mean? That shit has value and weight on it.
Yeah.
You know, and one thing that I think is really another positive thing about what is happening is showing, like, the universe showing us how strong we actually are, individually too, or how strong we need to be or should be. Right. You know what I mean? Like, I always tell Fatlip, I'm like, dude, you could be a millionaire, dude. Like, if your work ethic was a little bit more, you know, this, and I have these talks, I have these talks with him all the time, or I used to have the talks with him, because I like his work.
Right.
And I know there's more, and like, I see where he can block himself, and I'm like, dude, trust me, the life you've lived, all you got to do is just tell the truth.
Right.
Over record. Uh-huh. And just let it be. He got swagger. It's just in him. We all do.
Yeah.
You know, we all got something. There was always something about what it is that we're doing, you know, together.
Right, right.
You know, our showmanship, you know, like, I remember us coming together for Rock the Bells. It's like, once we hit that stage, our problems was, we didn't give a fuck what our problems was, because we honored the spirit of what it was when we were on stage and what we had to do for the crowd.
Right.
You know, one dude could be way over there and I can be way over here and we not getting along. But when we hit that stage, all that shit disappeared.
Yeah.
You know, and then what we're given and just, you even think that you couldn't even see a problem.
Yeah.
In our performance.
Yeah.
Because we're unified.
Yeah.
And that shit was just like, that's a beautiful, that, and I cried because like, that's a beautiful thing.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? That's a beautiful thing, man. Looking at, we did some great shit. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So that's the good stuff. And, you know, be real, like showing us how to, you know, make sure that, you know, we make sure we're getting paid for how we're doing things and, you know, how things are laid out and, you know, and not letting the bullshit get in the way of the big picture.
Right.
You can't let this bullshit get in the way of the big picture. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like if somebody don't want to do something, that's fine. We're still moving forward and that space is still open for you when you're ready to come back kind of thing. You know, like different things, you know.
Yeah.
And there's different dynamics. And, you know, there was times where we get bored with like singing the same song all the time, you know. Want to do something new. Want to do something fresh. Or, you know, there's so many turns to things. But one thing that's consistent is how you should look at the big picture, which is this is for the fans in the world.
Mm-hmm.
And you've been blessed with health and the opportunity.
Thanks for tuning into the Indie Playbook and our first half of our interview with Slimkid3. Make sure you check out next week for part two, where we'll get much more in depth. And if you enjoyed it, please subscribe. We're now available on the podcast app, TuneIn, and Stitcher. So stay tuned for more. We really appreciate the support. Talk to you next week. Peace.